Donc on a eu notre première table ronde qui évoquait l'aspect protéiforme immunitaire de ce qui existait en
monde sur le web dans la création artistique et avec ce second volet de cet après-midi, on va voir comment on compose ces différentes traces, ces différents objets protéiformes pour en faire des collections. Donc si je pars de ce postulat, si je reprends le titre de la table ronde, on va dire qu'on parle d'un go back to this title of the roundtable. We speak of the ancient order and the multifaceted, as we said at the beginning, to try and build up a new order, but that's a starting point. But I trust the four people on the floor to try and distort all this. That is, all in all, I mean, when we decide to create a collection, I mean, is it really structured? Is it, I mean, do we give a meaning to a whole enriched with description axes, with the definition axes, which are the same, or does it mean that a collection is kind of a permanent process, some sort of resonances which can be out of tune in a way? And if how do we possess, I mean, the collection when we collect? Because in the case of a digital aspect and a research engine, they create their own intelligence as well. And so aren't we dealing with two dimensions of a collection, that is a connection which would be aware and expected, and the one which emerges from the collecting process? Now, this is a kind of frame, a starting frame to discuss and debate together. I'm going to introduce all the various people here on stage, with ladies first. So Albertine Meunier, is an artist, a funny artist, as she describes herself, who all along her activity of creation is going to sort of tackle the gaffer, the data, and tease the data, if you may say so, and evolve in this kind of games, trying to put forward various things. Am I right? Right. Now, do not hesitate to give concrete examples to illustrate your speech as we go on through the debate. Then Carl Pineux, he's a researcher at the laboratory at, in Compiègne, at the COSTEC laboratory, that is knowledge technical systems. Now, to sum up, we're dealing with man, techniques, and society. He's also here because it's a second position, because Carl Pineux, with other colleagues, was Acatonian in 2017 and was awarded a prize in 2017 with a prototype which is called Musivi. We'll try to implement at Gallica, and then you try to explain, I mean, how in a, within a few hours, I mean, so the reinstall the kind of musical system through a prototype. The idea was to question a classical collection, and then within 40 hours, in, and try to deal with this library in a different way. Then Joachim Montessu is an artist, performer, sound artist, working around sound and voice with various media in France and around the world. Actually, he is very busy, as far as I know. And Joachim is going to explain a project which is called Vertigo also, by chance, which started in 2014, but I will tell you more about it. And he also has a kind of perception of sound voice and the way he sort of articulate those sounds and bring them to life differently in different performances. And what is he's going to explain, I mean, the his connection with the collection, and also his relation, in his relation he tried to explain, I mean, his relation to other collectors around what has been grasped in sound, enfin, voice, and performance. And Florent, last but not least,
Florent Aziosmanoff,
Florent Aziosmanoff,
qui est fondateur du Living Art Lab, qui a collaboré
the founder of
the
Living Art, who's collaborated with the Bibliothèque nationale de France. But I'll let you explain this part. And his work deals with autonomous behavior through artificial intelligence, trying to have various engine, search engine dialogue. Now we'll see how this interpretation and this use of AI will question an institution which is supposed to create and make collections durable. Like the institution of the BNF. I would like to start with you, Florent, as enough to explain this kind of state of the art within the framework of the BNF. Thank you. Good afternoon, and thank you for this invitation. And I would like to add up to what you said, saying that I've been a producer and author, also got interested in the possibility of the emergence of expression disciplines we would develop with the digital tools, and more specifically with AI, artificial intelligence. And I've been working on this for 20, 30 years now. Now, what I would like to develop now, to start with, I mean, I took the title you used, and then I changed and said disorder has disappeared. And roughly, I would like to briefly speak about the experience we had with the BNF and INREF Lab in Paris 8 for 3 years now. In fact, I was one of the founder of Art 3000, for those who are acquainted with the experience. And following this, we created Le Cube, and I was in charge of the various creations and programs. So I met people dealing with digital creation. We produce and produce and produce. We're not really equipped, but as far as we can, I mean, we try not to lose our files. But create. And then Alice Saladin, then from the BNF, multimedia collection, came to see us, and then Mary and said to me, well, look, I mean, Florent, you have a quite interesting digital corpus, and we are interested at our library to do maybe something with your collection, and what do you think? And I said, well, yes, that could be a good idea. And let's think about all this. Let's try to start a program around all this. And this is how, I mean, it took us 2 years to try and set up our project, trying to get some subsidies as well, and then we started this project, Digital Art and American Posterity. So I'm not going to describe the result of this research, but rather the direction and trajectory. Because when we completed our project, we thought, well, we've reached something. Now, this thing cannot work as it is, but it opens a kind of perspective, and it is a perspective we all face, and we would all be able to debate upon. So what does that mean? I'm going to take two examples of work, and I use these works to try and show the complexity of what we have to face. And then from this complexity, how do we try to dominate this complexity? Because the question was, how did we encounter the BNF? So the first work,
peut-être que l'ambiance peut être un petit peu moins forte. La première pièce que je vais montrer, c'est ça, c'est une installation qui vous paraît.
It's a kind of, installation, this kind of device, which was invented with Catherine Anglade. And what you should bear in mind is that this piece is not for a visual artist. She's not a visual artist, she's a choreographer. And now what's been made is that this kind of work, which is autonomous, but in connection with its spectrum, spectator, I mean, things develop and decompose depending on the behavior of the viewer. When you want to understand the work, what you should be able to envisage is the behavior of the viewer and how this viewer with the image, I mean, evolve together. And so this helps us to understand the complexity of the system, but also the idea is to apprehend what happens and what triggers, what is triggered, and what it is self-made through the behavior of the viewer. So this is a kind of element we cannot escape. Another work I want to show you is a piece I've been working which is an adaptation of the Mona Lisa, thinking of Harry Potter pictures. And I worked about the constitution of the virtual personality of the Mona Lisa, like Leonard da Vinci, I mean, thought and described it. So there's a kind of complexity. The complexity is to be able to restore movement, I mean, it's kind of real time. I mean, that person reacts depending on the viewer, just like what we saw before. Another complexity which is added to this is a kind of multifaceted. I mean, the way you can have access to this Mona Lisa is through a jewel, through a picture, another, or through an app, and many other artifacts, and maybe millions of artifacts around the planet, hopefully. Now, this is the complexity. I mean, how is this work revealed through a picture, through a smartphone, or whatever? And we have the various apps or support or equipment, I don't know how to call it, but we have a cloud reference as well, which means that when you look at your picture of the Mona Lisa, the attitude of the Mona Lisa mirrors the rumor of the whole world, of what all the others are experiencing around the world, and which builds up a kind of social network. I mean, how interesting is it? I mean, that's not the point, but we just have to be aware of this device, which is rather complex. It's not like saving a file, and you won't be able to do it if you save just a picture. So the idea was, how do we keep and how do we save this kind of system? Not in 2 years' time, trying to break all the computers, but what about in 2,000 years? What will remain out of all this? I mean, 2,000 years when there won't be any more computers, no more softwares, no more whatever. And in 2,000 years, I mean, we can look at the BNF and we can maybe laugh, but still, I mean, BNF has a kind of archive going back to 2,000 years yet.
À la fois pour répondre à plusieurs aspects de cette question, on a eu la chance de rencontrer.
But then to try and answer this question, I mean, we met Kostas Kostanas, who worked in Greece on the reconstitution of the Tavmata.
Aussi, comment dire, légendaire que l'étaient les
which were rather legendary, like the seven wonders of the world.
Et lui, il a reconstitué
and he sort of reconstituted things which really disappeared. There was no traces left, but he reconstructed them by analyzing the texts about this Tavmata. Reading in ancient Greek. He also did iconography, because iconography was not trustworthy. What was trustworthy and reliable were the texts. And he was an engineer, and he managed to rebuild, I mean, 300 of these artifacts and managed to make them operate. Now, these I can show you, I mean, sort of little theaters and different systems, but he also developed a kind of machinery with levers, palms, and cranes and things like that, like Leonardo Vinci. Leonardo Vinci was also acquainted and knew these texts. And it's actually similar to what Leonardo da Vinci did, because, I mean, they have read both the same texts. And so on, I mean, as taking the text as fundamentals, he managed to rebuild these pieces. Now, these digital pieces, with the digital system we have, we managed to keep and archive those objects. And with the object of our research, which is the same, I mean, the work of conservation, just like the BNF does with the computers, etc.
Alors, le principe était assez simple.
The principle was rather simple, that is, with our research, we would be able to know the works, try to rebuild them with the various means we had and tools, and then the description model should be universal. And I put universal in brackets, and all the brackets we can use around such a word, but then, that is, I mean, should be able to describe the object, but also try and describe the creation process whereby it was built up. And so, for example, say what happened in the author's mind, and then theoretical models also, theoretical models which may be revealed or not revealed, but that was the problem. But also reception conditions, that is, these works exist because they are materialized in the mind of the author. If you cannot describe the behavior of the author, then we miss a part of what should be kept and archived. And so then we reach that kind of a description model. So what you can see is rather big and complex. But I can also tell you that in the yellow space, what we do actually usually is that you have the orange bubble, that is, we create the work, we explain how the system is designed, and then we add up the starting or the genesis of the work, everything which deals with the performance of the work and in what kind of event it is shown. Event, situation, context, but also the critical aspect, which is also very interesting. The critical aspect should be able to document the work, and that's it. After 3 years, then we did all this, a lot of iteration, and we were quite happy with the result, and people making research, I mean, were people with corpuses, like me, for example, and then we took part of the game, and let's try to work on that, on all that work, and then we realized that it was nearly impossible because it was a huge work, and I worked on a work on the Mona Lisa, for example, another work, and we worked quite many days with the people in charge of the documentation, and it was frustrating in a way because at the end, I mean, I thought, well, I didn't do this, I didn't say this, I didn't say that, I forgot to say this, and I was not able to say this, I was not allowed to say this, blah, blah, blah. So, In a way, I mean, our process is perfect, and we could have done it even more perfect, but it can't be used concretely, because it is not realistic. As a producer, I will not have in my prod box, I mean, someone who's going to spend 2 months for a work to document it, and each time always say, well, we've just come out with something extra, and then we have to add it to the document, etc. No, it seemed quite a failure. It could have been a failure, or it's a kind of a time witness, in a way, it remains the time witness. This is a kind of thing I want to say, maybe artificial intelligence will be the solution to be able to diffuse the works with such a complexity with artificial intelligence, and that would be legitimate. How do we deal with artificial intelligence? Well, through machine learning, because as a producer, I'm not going to document the system, and the system will document itself using all the sources, formal, informal sources from internet, and the roundtable we had just before, I mean, it was wonderful to look at all this with the checking mechanism, etc. And also that there would be a kind of new learning system, knowledge learning, that is the trying to make available, because when it's been documented, it's very complex. We need to have access in a qualified manner, and we need a specific tools able to do this. For each interrogation. And so we may say, is this machine going to work properly? Not at all. Machine learning is a system which has been educated. It is submitted to human thought and human mind, and then the model should be perfected also, and then the system making things available will also develop with its time. And this is how I think that this system is not an automatic system, because we find the also how the institution is involved in all this, the BNF. And BNF, and maybe many BNFs or libraries, should be able to have the means and the flexibility to carry out such a work.
When mentioning collections, so we thought of a process with a text that would allow you to have access to all types of experiences that you can have, that you can find in the finished product. So it may be an emotional, intellectual type of appropriation process. That's what we call the experience. And here the experience is changing all of the time, because it decomposes and recomposes itself every time. So for the Mona Lisa project, for instance, if you look at the Mona Lisa, whatever the context, and even on social networks, where there's interconnection of emotions, because people feel something and share their experiences. So we have a collection of data, that's true. So we have identified data, standardized data, but through digital arts, we see that the trace is actually constantly evolving through interactions. So, Carl, how can we envisage a reflection around that topic? Would you follow up on Florent's opinion, saying that artificial intelligence may be the answer to the question, because collection of objects is something moving, so then we could have a machine that learns or keeps on learning all the time? Or have you any other idea? Well, I think this is a very complicated question. Well, I've come here today because I used to work at the BNF, and so we had a very nice job. The idea was actually in the audio music sector. So the idea was actually to perceive music, or to see how people perceive music directly through research interfaces. And this goes back to the question that was raised a few moments ago, because music or sound is something that you cannot see, it's something that you need time to understand. So it's very difficult to understand what sound is all about. And with my friends and the team, so we raised a question on how we could make sound visible. So for people who were on the database, on Gallica database, could actually look for a sound and see what it represents visually. So we had a look at two interfaces. So first of all, we said, okay, well, we will associate data or contents with the music, so pictures, photographs, and so on, so representing the person who is singing, or some documents also referring to the historic context in which the part was written or composed. And the other option, how to use or to make use of the spectrogram. So what is a spectrogram? Well, this is, in fact, the representation of the footprint of sound. And this allows you to visualize the sound. On the basis of that picture, you can have access to the metadata we have, so see whether the sound is of good quality or not, so you can see whether there is disturbing noise on the recording. Is it a unique sample of sound? So this is also something that was presented when we started prototypes, so when we have two identical recordings, so you can see that visually. And I forgot the question that you raised a few moments ago. So, but, well, yes. The question had to do with categories of artwork and putting them in categories through artificial intelligence. Well, this is what we tried to do, because we had an algorithm. An algorithm is some sort of IA. So this algorithm was able to generate pictures and to put sounds in categories. So we know that we have a certain number of DPMs, there we have 30 minutes of sound, or there we have parasite sound, so we cannot hear the recording and so on. So we can put them in different categories through algorithms. And then we can generate new ways of perceiving the data. We can generate clusters, groups of objects, and then we can put a label on them and create new collections on the basis of this algorithm. So if you go more into details, so if you have a whole set of artwork products and you have this clustering algorithm, well, this algorithm will put them in different categories, in different groups, and then we will see that artwork is in fact categorized in a certain number of categories of groups and subgroups. Well, I studied arts, of course, and it was quite frustrating at the time when I remember, because if there was no knowledge of art, you had to spend hours and hours looking for that knowledge, and you wouldn't have any answer. Now, thanks to the digital world, we have Wikipedia, we have also Wikidata, which is, brother application of Wikipedia. So this allows you to find all objects referring to the dog and this dating back to the 17th century and located at the Louvre Museum. So it goes very, very fast. And thanks to the description of data, so we can have access to this type of collection. So I don't know whether there is an issue with IA, but we've got to create the data first, and that's why it's very complex, because we need to put those data into the system, and of course putting data into the system means that you have to interpret them. And if you try to describe the properties of an object, you will speak about the height of the object, not about its depth. Well, the algorithm, of course, will work on the basis of its height and not of its depth. So these are the restrictions of artificial intelligence. But anyway, so artificial intelligence may provide us with some help to understand precisely how things are organized. Well, I would like to give the floor to your colleague in a few moments. So we try to keep this collection, the methodology is quite basic, and to keep it simple, to be real in an algorithm. We try to find a universal standard or an interoperational standard so as to understand precisely how things are evolving. And then we will try to keep neutral
une autre forme à la norme,
and
c'est-à-dire que la norme qu'on nous renvoie
the standard that is sent back to us with algorithms should not influence us, and we say, okay, we have a collection and we'll try to see it from a different angle. So regarding sounds and voices, Well, I suppose that we have some emotional reactions, some cognitive reactions when listening to something. So how can you change the way you look, or rather the way you listen to those noises or voices or sounds? And how can you transform that disorder that you're used to into something different? So good afternoon. First of all, I think that we are presently talking about different things. So we've got digital works that should be preserved, and we've got existing works of the past, of course, that we would like to put into some form of categorized catalog. And I think these are two different things. But regarding existing data, so existing work that we would like to re-qualify, so we have an accumulation of data that we would like to organize, to reorganize. So we would like to give more sense to those data, to put them into clusters that will generate sense. And as far as the other situation is concerned, we would like to give life to digital work through technical procedures that are not necessarily permanent. So it's a reinterpretation of work in a different way. So I think we've been dealing here with two different things, and the bridge also between, or the link between both things. So we suppose that data are the way we read things, we understand things today, and that they are permanent in time. So we take it for granted that we will give value, meaning to those things. Well, of course, we don't know how a computer will look like in 2,000 years. But anyway, we can keep those data and see whether we can work on that. Well, personally, I've got some doubts. There's a small work, so which is called "In Case Data Are Crying." Well, it's a small handkerchief on which you find inscriptions, data. So one of them is a slogan, actually: "Take care for yourself, take care for the others." Big data, and so on. And this is what remains. Also, losing data. So this may happen with everybody, of course. This may also happen with institutions. So you can start crying because you can't find those data, can't find them back. So this is a result of this accumulation. So this is the first observation. Second observation I'd like to make. I'm busy analyzing connected objects, and those objects actually that are trying to interpret the digital world. Think of Angelino, so which is one of the first connected objects that I analyze. It's a form of, it's a dancer, actually, a small dancer in the bottle playing music. It's connected. And this dancer will start turning and singing when Twitter emits the word angel. So we suppose that Twitter will go on forever, so we don't know if this will be the case, but I don't think so. We also think that Twitter never changes any data, so which is totally wrong. And well, this dates back to 2009, where I spent 7 years actually trying to restore this object. And I've got many connected products. I had them all put together. So when one of them was not working, so we had to repair it. And 2 weeks later, then it happened for the second one and so on. So it's an endless process. And we've got the illusion that we can keep things, but it's an illusion, it's a mere illusion, it's nothing more. Especially for artistic work, very complex work that do not depend on a type of equipment, also depend on the network and so on, it's an ecosystem of things. And then you try to keep that object alive. I think this is an illusion, and I would agree with you on the fact that we should give life back to some work that existed, it used to exist in the past at a certain moment in time. And the question is, how can we translate its existence on the basis of texts, videos, and so on? And as far as I'm concerned, well, I think this is important. Well, personally, I decided to put away that illusion. I cannot keep all my works alive. And It's like performances, you know, so you've got to document works, you've got to register things, to record things, to tell stories about those things. And even if it doesn't work, it's not important. So when you are looking at that object, you know that it has a history, you know precisely what the work should do. And people can imagine things. We can also simulate the way it used to work. But keeping an object alive, an object dates back to some time, and in 10 years' time, so this object will not work anymore. So it's totally useless. And how can we do that? That's the question. I don't know whether you know PAMAL, so under the responsibility of Emmanuel Gaz, working on the preservation of works and processes, and they were interested in keeping alive the Minitel system. And, well, yes, they've got bits and pieces of things, but these things are not complete. And I personally think that what makes up the world in which we're living is that fragile aspect. So nothing guarantees that servers will go on working, that our equipment will go on working forever. The only thing that we know, that we can be sure, of course, is that paper will never disappear. So that's the only certainty we have. And of course, tissues and handkerchiefs, well, we still need them. And just as a joke, I've got a piece of work which is called My Google Search History. It's an inventory in the form of a book, of course, of all searches and keywords that I put in Google over a period of 10 years, two volumes, more than 500 pages. So all search words, of course, that have no sense, even no meaning, even for myself. But people who collect things, well, personally, I collect my personal life, the events of my personal life through those books, but people who are real collectors, collectors of data, are big players like the BNF. Well, collecting things, of course, doesn't mean that you organize them, so it's simply keeping them there so as to collect them for some time. Joachim now. So if you have to accept this fragility of collections, volatile things, and if my curiosity accompanied because I have a dodo bird, for instance, used to live some hundreds of years ago, but it will never shout and never make any sound anymore. So let's imagine that you collect such things. How can you imagine your collection and how do you organize? Rather, what would be the idea of your work for the future? So how could we understand your performances in 10 years' time, 100 years' time, 1,000 years' time? Or is it volatile? Well, this is an interesting, precise question. And I was wondering what I would say, what I would say actually. So regarding this trace, it's fairly simple. When I started at the beginning of the 1990s, and I decided to refuse any form of archives, as far as I was concerned at the time, because I was busy with music, sounds, and so on. Well, we had to record a certain number of things, to publish a certain number of things, and the career of an artist in sound, in music, means archiving. So I decided not to put anything on any form of media. Well, of course, this may cause some difficulties sometimes. But anyway, so I decided to say no to my nose. And what will remain in 1,000 years' time? Well, personally, I think it's very far from me, and I'm not interested in that. But decided to let go on that. And while Bertine was talking, well, I was thinking of a festival of performances that I went to in the 1980s, and I was discussing with Esther Ferrer. Well, I hope you know her. She's a very good performer. And in that occasion, actually, we had 30 photographers in a room with 60 people. And she said, well, you know, that's what actually kills the performance, so to speak. And I had this feeling that recording was not necessary. For performances or what concerts and so on. Well, I thought it very useful actually that she would tell me that. And for some artists, it's a form of discipline where they say, okay, well, I will let go and not record in that situation. But for digital art, I think it's exactly the same. So I decided to let go and keep some distance, put some distance between me and digital art, so I try not to leave any traces. And paradoxically, so I started a collection 20 years ago so with the Erotum label for music. So it's a paradox as far as I'm concerned. So it's the first piece written by Marcel Duchamp, who invented so-called chaotic and chaotic music, together with John Cage. Random music. So I decided to create that collection with audio art, music, and the paradox was complete because I wanted to publish the works of those people, but not to publish my work. So it's an effort for me to make discs and so on, to put things on specific media. It was some form of torture, but at the same time, so I really could find some pleasure in it. And to answer your question, well, as far as I'm concerned, so I was more focusing on coding and decoding, and I think this is an interesting way to have access to art, because I can agree or disagree with a certain number of things. And in artificial intelligence, well, I think I was fascinated by the potential of artificial intelligence, but my job, my work would actually consist in finding the line, or the connection with the past, so 2,000 years ago, and see what the relation is between consciousness and reality. Nothing that's what I'm interested in, and music is there to do that. So coding is important. What does it mean? What is digital world? Can we get out of the digital world? Coding, is it a metaphor? Is it a way of representing some process which is much deeper than that? Well, these are questions that I raised a few years ago, and I haven't got any answer, because we can find many views or many ideas with people. So do we encode things in a proper way with our thoughts and so on? So I try to establish links between those things. It's very complex, of course, because you touched upon poetry, mathematics, techniques, art at large. And I wanted to focus more on art, on the artistic aspect. It was a bit vague, but the question was vague. So that's why I wanted to summarize things. Well, giving a broader dimension to the reality is a way of having a smaller context so as to apprehend this reality that is in this. So encoding things, coding things, is a way of reducing the immensity of reality so as to be able to grasp its boundaries. And with the big data, so we've got the impression that we just do the contrary. So we systematically multiply the data, multiply the reality. And if we go back to this paradox that you mentioned a few moments ago, so how do we, how do you apprehend these ideas, so digital things regarding, well, through IT, mathematics, binary systems, and so on? So is it an approach that allows you to increase the reality, or is it a way of reducing reality so as to be able to apprehend it properly? Well, in my opinion, I would say that I'm one of those people who think that artificial intelligence will certainly be as strong as the invention of writing. We know that the fact of being able to write has allowed people to thoughts live through centuries. But it has some restrictions, and one of those limitations has to do with the fact that I've got to search for information, not to look for information. And this is interesting because artificial intelligence allows you also to put a name on information and to give information to everybody in a shape that corresponds to reality. And I think this is what is important. We started to... People put cones on jars, for instance, to know precisely what type of quantity of wheat was contained in those. It was reduced in the past, and now so we do the same with the digital data. So we cannot imagine how things would evolve and how they would be interpreted in the future. So we, of course, focus on the machine learning, but it's not really important. So in fact, using a mouse on a computer device, for instance, it's okay, it's very helpful. But if I want to find something, well, I will find something. If I'm looking for a cat, well, a cat, and so on. So that's the limitation of artificial intelligence. We are at the very beginning of artificial intelligence. And for such a precise question, I would give the answer for myself, because we'll try to find an answer that will be understandable at this very moment. But we've got to open up our eyes and look at the future. So you raise the question of collections. Well, I think that collections are useful, and they will be useful in the future. So they will be useful for researchers. They will certainly emerge at one moment in time. Another observation I'd like to make, so you said a few moments ago that you had opted for not recording things, and Martine said that it was impossible to do it, but that she tried to do it, and so on. Well, as a producer, I know that if I have one more second in my day's time, then I will try to produce something instead of keeping something. That's why we sometimes lose track of the past. But as we work together, so with the BNF, the producers, and so on, so we've got different jobs. And there is something important with the Mona Lisa. You can see it. You can also buy a poster because the production is about the same size and the result is quite similar. But it's not enough. Because if you look at reports that were written in the past, you know that she hasn't got any eyebrows, for instance. And they say that in those ancient reports that all the eyebrows were drawn in a different way and so on. And even if you look at the books published by the Louvre Museum, in the 18th century, so it seemed to be the standard at Louis the 14th court, so people had to remove their eyebrows and so on. So that's what people say. I wanted to know whether she was a prostitute or whether it was somebody who had been plucked her eyebrows at late stage. So I tried to find traces of that in the past, in written texts. And that's why I'm very thankful for those people who collect things and keep them. So let's go back to the first question, and then we'll come back to the second part of the question. So regarding the first question regarding the code, is it a widening out of our scope or a restriction of our scope? Well, I think it's both of them. I think that Joachim will certainly have a more precise description than mine. Agreeing on a code is agreeing on the way we can express our things. We can express things. It's like an ontology. It's, you know, when programming in a dynamic language, it will produce sentences, and everybody will agree on the fact that they understand the sentence, whether the person on the other side is a person or a machine, a computer. So this allows us to widen our scope of our knowledge and data, and that's why in cultural institutions we open APIs, we standardize data and so on, because we want to speak the same language. But sometimes we have the reverse or the contrary situation of that situation, because we have standardized a certain number of things, and two words that are synonyms are not really synonyms, so we will make use of one word so as to be able to understand each other, but then knowledge will disappear. Some part of knowledge will disappear. So I entirely agree on the fact that you said a few moments ago that digital works should be preserved and so on. Well, MCVs, for instance, is something we launched 8 months ago, but it doesn't work anymore, so something is broken. So it's true that this theoretic standardization is certainly no guarantee of eternity, whatever.
I wanted to bounce back on what you said, because in the work we did as a producer regarding this question about coding, decoding softwares, I mean, what we use, I mean, induced forms we are submitted to, I mean, the model of working, I mean, as a starting point, I mean, we didn't care about the technique. What was very important is that we had access to what was, I mean, to the thought, I mean, what the person had in mind and what the person was willing to express. What is interesting regarding the technique is that thanks to the technique, I can materialize my thought. But what is interesting is that this thought is being constituted this way. For example, regarding Pierre Fou, managed to be materialized because there was this thought which could be identified and could explain. And then I try to tackle these digital questions in that way, because I mean, we have to master the technology, but we also have to be acquainted with the mind. And the way of thinking. And for example, when you speak about your tools and your devices, I mean, that's what fundamentally is interesting. It's not how you manage, but how you start thinking of something you were not thinking about before. Yeah, you're right. And then regarding code, decoding, etc., this has kind of dual reading system which enriches and augment what we are going to generate as objects. We cannot necessarily read or organize. So it's a kind of extra which is not readable. And at the same time, which sort of flatten everything in a way, we smooth and bring everything to the same level. Now, coding, decoding, encoding, etc. I mean, we can use all the particles and all syllables before the term is a kind of a hullabaloo. I mean, it's a kind of mixture. I mean, coding, decoding, encoding, full of layers, different layers. And I think that the world, I mean, to me, the world is really cannot be read anymore. I mean, we generate many things, bits and pieces. We generate programs which have a meaning. Or I mean, we just have to follow. I mean, to follow the movement. But things to me are sort of illegible. The more we give legibility, but due to the mass of tools we have, then sort of recreating a kind of blurred situation, we can't read anything. Well, I fully agree with you. I mean, it's a full chance, and it's a full disorganization. I mean, you give a definition of the code, and my view of the code is not the same. I mean, yours can be has a value, but to me, I mean, it's something which is going. It's like a seed, and from this seed, something grows, giving a kind of information and information in depth of why the seed grows. So, taking an example. I would like to quote Joël Steiner, experimental researcher, and he was called Évariste. People knew him. He was a kind of alternative Jacques Dutronc singer, and rather funny at that time. And he managed to support his project with this performance, and then it disappeared. And since 1967, I mean, he's been going through the media, but then it disappeared. But his fundamentals was rather simple. I mean, he had a kind of experimental equation, making the link between the structure of the protein, so really working on the living element, so the protein was the first body constituting the molecule with a value chain, working on the chromatic range to start. I mean, a protein will trigger a melody, a channel of notes, and then from then he started decoding his protein structures, thousands of them, and he did it with his software. He developed his own protocol, and then he experimented. He started broadcasting and spreading this on the living world and organic world, and he reached quite interesting results working on the intensity, on the volume, but also on the speed of the speed at which the note would be played. And then now he's old. For some of my friends, we consider that he's one of the greatest avant-gardists in science, who was criticized, of course, by some people. But for others, I mean, he was a real genius. Of course, I mean, we cannot prove everything he claims, but it works. I mean, and what is interesting is being able to diffuse, I mean, this kind of melody on plants to try and get rid of viruses, for example. And we can have a kind of impact in the food industry with little things, just only by hitting this question about the code and see how it works. And so he opened that little box, thinking it really paradoxical, because we are in the world of finance, in the world of quantum physics. How does that work? I mean, what is the role of the observer? Who is the subject there? I mean, is the plant a separate object, et cetera, et cetera? And so it's becoming rather complicated. But despite all this, I mean, there are some results we can observe. And so personally speaking, I mean, I was fascinated for 15 years. I mean, I discovered Steinemann in 1998. It was for 20 years now. I've been thinking about a way we could apply this to art and how we can sort of raise the new question about the code and on, how does that work? Now, someone like Steinheimer is sort of doing a kind of comeback. I mean, comeback was something very ancient and very old, and saying also that artists and musicians are very often in this relation to the reality, inspiration, enthusiasm. I mean, you can capture things. I mean, the artists are sort of medium people. They manage to grasp something. I mean, sometimes we think it's just nonsense, but still, I mean, we are all a kind of senses, because we grasp information. So the idea, so the question was, how do we grasp this information? And he realized that many musicians, I mean, embed in their compositions protein structures in a way. And so this relation with the world of the living is very interesting beyond reason. And I mean, every day I think about it, and I always raise the question about the ratio. I mean, between poetry, language, music. I mean, everything was not separated from medicine. I mean, before. I mean, long time ago. And now we managed to split in various sequences. And now we try to bring back and reconstruct this whole puzzle, and this big puzzle. And so, but I think that we can manage it with experimental science, but also with music, because in music things happen. I mean, in terms of history, I mean, sound, experimental poetry, for example. To my mind, I mean, it was a kind of historical confusion, because we thought Marinetti did a construction act because he was at the time of Mussolini, where we destroy the language, which in a way is true, but also wrong at the same time. It depends on the point of view. It depends on what you would like to look at. And with, I think that this kind of language, which appeared at the beginning of the last century, was maybe a new way of reinventing code of what the language can create, because language is just like proteins. I mean, language is probably the capacity of creating something and say, for example, and say something and then something is going to be created. How does that work? It's a complete mystery, but still, I mean, it exists. It's really interesting as a definition. I mean, the kind of definition you put forward. I'm interested in cultural institution, but in cultural institution we are in this sort of creation phase of codes with the object. We cannot really qualify, and but we have this hackathon like the BNF offers, but it's because also it is difficult. We don't really know how we're going to explore what we are creating and how we're going to decode all this data. And it's interesting to see that, globally speaking, there are a little few projects of that we're going to be able to reuse. Because when you think about Gdata, Europeana, BNF, many, there are many tools. But then maybe it's because we do not understand, decode this way of operating, and capture, grasp. And this is very important as terms, because when we decided to make an account of all this, to reconstruct, I mean, we try upstream and downstream. We try to use the right sensors and describe them so that they would be understood later. And regarding this kind of capturing, that is enclosing or a fix on a specific support for cultural and industry, but also business. But capture, I mean, who defines it? Who defines this capture and capturing aspect? Is it a different job? Is it the person himself? Or is it the final reader or the final person with sort of a reappropriation? And because one of the capture is sensor, is the emotional experience at the moment, or is it the kind of reappropriation of the fact that I'm going to describe something, and how would you react regarding this notion that Joachim spoke about? I think that in the notion of this sensor we mentioned is the kind of form. How are you going to shape? How are you going to shape what you've measured or sensed or captured? And then you take a DNA code, you give a shape to something, and we come to the question of shaping something you perceive. So it is more about materializing something you capture, and then you can reach thousands and thousands of shapes, because you take data, you're going to interpret those data, and then you're going to give a shape to your reflection, and then maybe you'll discover something you've never seen before, never heard about before, never perceived beforehand. So maybe you make something, something emerges which is unheard, unsaid. And I can see some artists using machine learning to create new works. I'm not talking about imitating ancient works, but most of the time they speak about of a collection, a kind of a data collection. Data collection to try and create a shape, a new shape, whether it is known or unknown. But then with this accumulation of new artifacts being created, then we managed to create unsaid and unheard artifacts, which can raise new questions about the way you look at the world. So this is what is rather interesting and created, sort of unprecedented artifacts. And sometimes there are things that we can capture, but we cannot interpret. With this new shape and new programs, now we reach unprecedented things, things we've never seen before. Now, regarding this capturing aspect, we feel that we capture something, a kind of objective sequence, because in fact, say something very simple. I mean, we have these temperature sensor or presence sensor. It's already capturing. It is edited. And I decided to capture this or that, and then I look at what I've captured and I interpret it immediately. It's high, it's low, it's cold, it's warm, or whatever. I mean, it's a way of thinking which is operating. So you have the capturing of the traffic in Paris, for example. And then we can see this on the roadmap. It's red or green, or red is a traffic jam, green is it's flowing, and sometimes red is peak hours, and green is relaxed or whatever. So there's a system which interprets the situations. Sometimes we may say, well, in that way, because of that code, I mean, it means that there's a traffic jam there, so that people wouldn't go in that direction. So even capturing is like editing. And with the digital, I mean, we think whether if it's objective, it's O or 1 or whatever. And so we're dealing with the thinking system which are applied. So, and we should be acquainted with that. And now, is it the reason why you're saying no trace, Joachim? I mean, we sort of enclose something. I mean, I would not be able to answer this question. Anyone in the audience who would have a joker for Joaquin?
Refuse a
capturing? Well, with Esther, that's what I said. I mean, she was really drowned. She had enough of looking at these performances. People taking pictures, etc. But regarding this performance question, and I would like to speak about the collection aspect. The performance then it goes back to the 60s. To my mind, it's only an interpretation. And this is my point of view, that there is a kind of ambiguous ratio and a romantic ratio, that is react without leaving any work, and saying that it is worth for the people who are here only, and that's it. Some of the people would think differently, saying that we do not want works anymore, or piece of work, work pieces anymore. We just want to live. And so it would be nonsense to try and record and archive things which has been experienced. And so I wouldn't agree with trying to archive something which was supposed to remain and be experienced at a time it was created. And so we are in a situation where sometimes we are with objects being collected, to bounce back on what's been said before, which are pictures which have been taken very quickly, published very quickly, hang quickly, but we don't care about the quality. because it was not meant to be so. But then we are not reaching this kind of quintessence, climax of quintessence of the piece of art. And this is going to be presented as the most important work of art. And this has been experienced. It's the only trace we have from the artist. But it's like using a polemic. And sometimes it's going back to the negatives we have of pictures and then try to edit and restore very nice pictures. And we've seen everything regarding performance. And most recently, and I will conclude on that, around the years 2000, there were artists who could enter all the institutions, Tokyo Palace institutions, and they would exhibit in those palaces and would claim never retrospective, well, so what, why? Why not? Why no retrospective? Would they be afraid of the critics that would be criticized in a few years? It's kind of falling into negationism. There are artists, anti-artists. Who are they? And I will stop with this polemic, but the position is complex. We do not want any trace, but we want something to remain, and we're going to sort of read again, and the traces are rather complex, and you spoke about the difficulty of describing what I have done, because the technological process anyway is going to disappear very quickly, so it would be a good thing maybe to try and tell when it's been made and how it's been made. So I think that our interest is really to reflect upon who did what and when. And that's where the performance is in a way contradictory, because it wanted to mark the history, but then history should be able to speak about it later. And that's where there's a kind of a contradiction I was talking about, this kind of romantic contradiction. So I'll stop here, and I would like to add during this debate. I mean, we spoke a lot about the collection. We didn't give a proper definition, but then it defined by itself, because each of you had its own definition of what a collection is. But I think that today we are in a situation where we start having collections of collections, which was not the situation before. I mean, in the past, where there was some object to be collected, and we could find some rules because these objects were limited. And then beyond this, it was very simple. I mean, we would collect stamps, cheese labels, or whatever. And now this has disappeared. Now, but the limit between this Greco-Roman collection and the collection of stamps and camembert labels, I mean, there's a kind of a continuum between both. I mean, there's a multitude of an awful lot of objects being collected, but what makes sense is the set collector. How does he produce the image of the world? And that's difficult to code, and that's where I would stop.
Je juste rebondir très brièvement.
Je suis absolument pas en désaccord. I do not really disagree with what you said. On the contrary, but I will not claim for art destruction. But performance is a non-place. It's a.
À mon sens. Doivent être peut-être un peu dépassés.
And I think we should go beyond all this and raise new questions regarding art, because we are in the field of art. What do we archive? What do we? I mean, do we have trace? No trace? Positions? Opinion? Different opinion? But then, how do we go beyond all this? And that's what I am obsessed by. I have a position and I try to describe something. I've been trying to define for many years now, but trying to get out of this object dialectic. What does art mean? If we take a group of artists, for some artists, art is life. Well, then let's try to push that to the limit, and then we encounter meeting Vicantin or whatever. I mean, the relation with the reality should be questioned at the core of art, and we haven't done this. So that's where we are in the field of poetry, talking about performance. But it's at the core of poetry that we have the best way of thinking. And regarding collection, then it's not really my field, but it's interesting. I think what's important for our debate is the relation between art and the trace.
En tant que producteur, enfin en tant que praticien, auteur aussi.
As a producer, practitioner, author. I think art follows a kind of trajectory with its specificities.
Et ça génère de la trace.
And this generates
d'autres font, prennent. Et en fait, ce qui est vraiment, c'est ça, c'est de
the artist works on his specificity and expresses that. And then whether we are traces, pictures we take, we do not take, I mean, that does not belong to him. Sometimes, I mean, he has to deal with it, sometimes he does it spontaneously, but in a way, I mean, this is none of his business in a way. This is the business of the rest of the society. We are all together, no artists to look at it, and we look at those works. And looking at these works also, I mean, there's something lacking if we do not manage to encounter and meet the artist. And that's kind of a role game. I mean, talking about, I mean, what the person from the Fondation Lafayette was talking about and saying that he would ask the artist, he would agree whether we can publish this or that part of this work, or, well, why not? Fair enough. But in fact, we don't care. And if one day we have to sign contracts, then we'll sign those contracts, and then we ask the right questions. But it's just. What I think, because these are sort of different trajectories, but it's all together that we create something. Regarding the collection, this has been haunting me for quite a while. Does the collection need a collector? What is a collection today? Now, for some time now, I thought I would start collecting collections. Now, I'm interested in data. Now, everything now which operates software programs need data collections. And I don't know who these collections belong to. Some of them can be uploaded, and there's a site which is called ImageNet with an awful lot of images to describe things, and this can be uploaded. And so I felt like uploading all these data collections and then create collections of these collections. Then I don't know who would be interested in that. Maybe a rare collection. And so the collection is strikingly enough, rather present in my reflection. And it's really factual.
regarding collection, I think you know Kenneckel Smith, who is the founder of Ubu.com, and we met 10 years ago, sharing with about 50 people on the planet, and we're all obsessed by music, and so we created a kind of shared, private shared server, a kind of network, a dark web. We would share thousands of music pieces, the avant-garde music, and within 10 years, I mean, the technology stopped working, the software was obsolete, and then everything stopped after 10 years, but then we managed to accumulate a mass of the things, and it was monstrous, and 4 tera of pieces, MP3, FLAG, whatever. But in terms of music, it is very important. Millions and millions of pieces, we just don't know what to do with it. I mean, it would take 5 years, I mean, to listen to all of this. Now, what should we do with this collection? Because we are aware of the fact that maybe we are the only ones on the planet having shared so much information. It feels like having the BNF in my pocket. It's really extraordinary. And we tried to widen everything, but he did it with Ubu. But Ubu is the top of the iceberg. And we don't know what to do with all these data. We'll try to archive them and keep them, but it's like a paranoia, because you have an object, and then you have a copy of copy of copy to try and avoid the crash and try and avoid losing everything. You're right. I mean, it's kind of accumulation. Collection is accumulation of objects, and it goes along with what I said before. I mean, how should we shape all this? What kind of shape do we give to that? How do we perceive? How do we feel it? And then maybe the kind of shape we could imagine to this rare collection. So it's beyond this collection. How do you shape, how do you create your collection, and how do you share it also? Maybe at the beginning of the collection, whatever the collection, is a criteria for sparing, because otherwise, I mean, a collector, I mean, if he lives in a studio or if he lives in a 5-room flat, well, fair enough. But otherwise, I mean, any collector, from the amateur, but even the BNF, sometimes it's a problem. You lack space. You can be overflown by so much. Yeah, you can. You don't have so that much space. And to collect or gather, I mean, he's also making choice, because in this collection system, in my mind, the collector and the collection in at the library, I mean, the term was defined in a different way, talking about digitized works, and you're going to deal with the collection of digitized work. But what was most important was a PDF of the instructions for the washing machine, for example. I was digitized. Same for what I showed you before. So in this collection, there are way of thinking, technical way of thinking, technological ways of thinking, a scientific way of thinking, or legal way of thinking. So we have instruction leaflet, but also laws, but it goes to the private private aspect also. I mean, all these are collections, so we have to know the collection we're talking about. I share your observation regarding the kind of obesity of the collection and overflow of this collection, and so we really have to define what a collection is. I mean, a collection is a document with other documents most of the time, and when we take the definition of the document, then the document is a collection of information and data which has been provided by someone. And so if it's not received and read by someone, this is not a document.
This is one of the definitions of a document, but of course, I mean, there are several definitions of a document. And if we take and we keep to that definition, then if we have a big collection, then this big collection cannot be read or heard in the case of music. And then we raise the question of what a collection is, because that cannot be viewed or interpreted or heard. And then we raise the question of the access. How do you access? How do you have access to this collection? Again.
Non, juste Pascalie Sortel, qui donc dirige le département.
Pascalie Sortel is the head of the audiovisual department. A kind of a practical question as a conclusion, maybe, and now regarding your job and how. What do you think of the collection? I mean, what would the definition, your definition of the collection, you would give?
Oui, on part avec ces propositions.
We start with
d'un acte très volontariste de constitution.
We start from
par des experts ou par des
a willing
on est avec le numérique dans une autre disposition
policy. I mean, in the digital field, we are in a situation of a positive accumulation, and then the collection will be built afterwards. So we collect first, I mean, as much as we can. We do not constitute this collection, and the question of how the collection is being used is not raised upstream. I mean, the use comes later. The research, we do not know yet, will build up usage we're not aware of, and we are, again, I mean, a kind of... we are in a way of thinking about the digital aspect in a different way, and then how do we build up collections through data, for example, and this is what is interesting in terms of appropriation and new usage we don't think of, and this is the difficulty of our job today. There's also a continuum with what when we speak about the copyright or dépôt légal. It is supposed to be exhaustive and neutral. I mean, the copyright of any document, whatever the quality criteria on the work, but then after that there will be a kind of collection of rare work of art, but later on, again, historian will rethink the collection, have a new way of looking at the collection, and this compilation and this phenomenon of accumulation would have a meaning, but then this meaning may change with the history. Now, in a collection, now I create because I give a scientific view or creative view, or I am entrusted with a cultural assignment, and then I have to compile something. The fact of compiling all my data, but sort of data you're talking about, but then I do a kind of make a kind of a heritage because I accumulate at a specific time.
Je ne sais pas comment l'exprimer, juste, effectivement, je rebondis sur l'aspect usage. Et
regarding the usage, use aspect.
Permettez-moi de vous appeler Joachim.
And I think of Joachim talking about Steinheimer.
Je pense que Stockhauser aussi.
And I think Stockhauser also.
Suite, je ne me rappelle plus quel mathématicien il l'interprétait de la.
Did something similar because he used some mathematics which he translated into music. But you, as a composer, for example, instead of looking for a specificity, Florent was talking about the inverse approach to find a kind of universality in music, in the musical language. It seems that Bach, for example, created his own language, and depending on his work and his compositions, then they can be performed, and we can find a kind of musical coding, and depending on the coding, we identify the kind of emotion we should feel from this work. And to me, artificial intelligence is to start, as the lady said, to start from data, kind of data storing, and then the usage will come later by identifying, depending on the context, the evolution of the world, the technology, and then we'll deduct some use practices. Now, to sum up, is this inverse approach of musical language would not allow to find usages, applications, as you talking about Ircam, to apply this to plants, or I'm sorry, I'm not really clear, but I'm not a composer.
I agree on what you said regarding Bach, for instance. And that's also part of the paradox, because a quantic physician, or physicist rather, will observe a certain number of results, and he knows that people believe in a certain, also in, will have specific beliefs, so then we'll call on a second observer, so to try to make things more objective. And we understand, of course, more subtle than that. In music, it's exactly the same. So you can have a certain number of notes, and this will put in a certain emotional state that will be totally different from other people. It's subjective. And two people listening to the same music may have different reactions. But anyways, what is important, as the case with Bach, so you cannot, there is a reaction, so you cannot stay insensitive. Or and that's what Sternheimer said, for those composers, think of Bach, Mozart, so there is something activating feelings. I propose that you go on talking with each other outside. I would like to thank you very much, all of you, for my questions. And I would like to thank also the people here in the room for their attention. Thank you very much.